Margaret Kimberly is a co-founder and editor and senior columnist for Black Agenda Report. She is the author of Prejudental, Black America and the Presidents, and a contributor to the anthologies Killing Trayvons, an anthology of American violence in defense of Julian Assange, and Capitalism on a Ventilator, the impact of COVID-19 on China and the US. Her work as an activist includes leadership roles in the Black Alliance for Peace and the United National Anti-War Coalition. Margaret, over to you.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Good day, everyone. Thanks for getting up so early and joining us, some of you very early. I want to thank the International Manifesto Group for inviting me to participate in this webinar on such an important topic. Of course, we're focusing on Palestine, but I'm going to digress a little and begin my remarks by talking about Haiti. Just a brief overview of its history. I feel like I would be remiss if I didn't bring it up. And I'll make connections between the two nations. Haiti was the home of Taino people before Christopher Columbus arrived there on one of his many invasions in 1492. Indigenous people were wiped out on that island that was first called La Española by the Spanish. Disease and forced labor killed them off there and throughout the Caribbean in one of the worst and one of history's worst examples of mass murder. As always happened in this hemisphere, competition among European nations played a role in Haiti's history. The French succeeded in interloping upon the Spanish claim, and eventually Spain ceded the western third of the island to them. The eastern portion became the Dominican Republic. The French plantation system was particularly cruel, even by the standards of chattel slavery systems of that day. Enslaved Africans were quite literally worked to death as they produced sugar and tobacco. However, in 1804, they succeeded in defeating the French in a successful revolt. But Haiti was so valuable to France, they were forced to recoup their loss by selling their possessions on the North American mainland, what we know as the Louisiana Purchase. And in a great irony of history, the United States profited from the Haitian revolt of enslaved people by securing even more land to expand their own plantation system. But France was not done. In 1825 and again in 1838, they sent warships and threatened to re-enslave Haiti unless they were paid money, millions of francs. So great was the debt that it was not paid off until 1947 and was estimated to total what would now be $25 billion. When you hear that Haiti is the poorest country in the Western Hemisphere, you should know this heist is the reason for the continuing poverty. And I begin with Haiti because we see a connection with another liberation struggle. Haiti has never been allowed to be a sovereign nation, suffering from US occupation, the kidnapping of its president, a UN occupation which brought cholera and the deaths of 10,000 people. A puppet organization, the Organization of American States, forced Haiti to stop accepting financial help that Venezuela gave to that country. And those Petrocaribe funds were stolen by their corrupt oligarchs, who are the true government of that country. And so we must remember all of this when we're told that Haiti needs more foreign intervention. Every nation has a right to sovereignty, the right to control its own destiny. The Palestinian people have been denied that right as they were expelled from their homes in the Nakba, the catastrophe which formed the state of Israel. Israel is an apartheid ethno-state, which is fiercely protected by the United States and the NATO alliance. France went so far as to try to ban pro-Palestinian protests, but people ignored the edict and thousands of them gathered there as they did around the world. The people who stepped up to protest against Israel's latest mass killing spree in May of 2021 should know that they changed things. It's important to know that Israel lost so much legitimacy around the world that they were forced into a little window dressing. And longtime Prime Minister Netanyahu was replaced. But Palestinians still have their homes destroyed. or are forced to destroy them themselves in order to avoid paying for demolition costs. Gaza is still a prison, and its people are forced to become spies in exchange for having permission to leave, even when they need medical care. The walls surrounding Palestine are higher than the Berlin Wall, and people wait under brutal conditions to go to Israel to work as cheap labor. Kids have long been in cages in Israel, and they're used as human shields by the IDF as they terrorize the population. There are so many rules of international law that are broken by the Israeli state. Exacting retribution against the civilian population is a direct violation of the Geneva Conventions, for example. I wrote in Black Agenda Report that Israel's treatment of the Palestinians is the clearest example of a litmus test. There's no question that Israel practices apartheid, just as it was practiced in South Africa. You are either on the side of humanity and morality and legality, or on the side of Israel. There can be no fence straddling or equivocation when one witnesses the ongoing state-sponsored terror against Palestinian people. Black people in the United States are uniformly on the side of the Palestinian cause. That has always been the case. Malcolm X visited the Khan Yunis refugee camp in Gaza in 1964, and he posed this simple and obviously rhetorical question in his essay, Zionist Logic. Quote, did the Zionists have the legal or moral right to invade Arab Palestine, uproot its Arab citizens from their homes, and seize all Arab property for themselves, just based on the religious claim that their forefathers lived there thousands of years ago? Unquote. The problem has never been with the vast majority of Black people and brave leaders like Malcolm X, but with what passes for leadership and the treatment meted out to those who dare to speak up. But this year was somewhat different, as Congressional Black Caucus members such as Cori Bush, Andre Carson, Ilhan Omar, and Ayanna Pressley made statements condemning the attacks on Al-Aqsa and mobs attacking Palestinians and the theft of land. But unfortunately, we see people such as Representative Ilhan Omar in particular will often begin condemning Israel, but then fold under pressure, backtracking and denouncing her own comments. Black people in the US don't have sovereignty any more than Palestinians do. And a politician like Omar will start out with good intentions, but end up condemning the people she should be supporting by calling Hamas a terrorist group and Israel a democracy. What are the points of commonality between Haiti, Palestine, and other nations targeted by the US government and its allies? They are all under imperialist attack. It makes no sense to discuss the privations of various people around the world without getting to the heart of the matter. I'm a member of the Coordinating Committee of Black Alliance for Peace, and this is a portion of our May 17th statement linking Palestinian solidarity with Black liberation. Quote, as Black internationalists, we will always be in solidarity with the Palestinian people as they struggle against US imperialism and Zionist settler colonialism. We understand that there will be no freedom for Palestine or for, excuse me, or for any of the nations and peoples of the world still oppressed by the pan-European colonial capitalist project without the development of a powerful movement at the center of that project here in the United States, unquote. The Palestinian struggle, of course, has unique features, but it cannot be separated from other struggles. We see the US providing $3 billion per year to Israel. And unfortunately, the same politicians who may speak up or will still agree to fund the obscenely astronomical Defense Department budget that includes money for the countries they sometimes condemn. That is also how Palestine is linked to our struggle here. Defense spending in the United States, some $750 billion annually, is 60% of all discretionary spending. It is literally why we cannot have nice things. It becomes pointless to ask why our infrastructure fails or why we don't have government-funded healthcare or better schools. That is why the Black Alliance for Peace statement is so important. When we protest on behalf of Palestine or the right of Haitians to be rid of US puppets or against sanctions, which are war by other means, we are fighting against the colonial capitalist project. There's no reforming the way our Congress does business or hoping that politicians will suddenly see the light and vote against the National Defense Authorization Act, which gives money to Israel and to Venezuelan coup plotters as well. The Palestinians are just one group who need our support and our defense, but none of our efforts will be fruitful if we think that the system itself will, the system will accommodate itself to what we want in Palestine or Venezuela or Syria or anywhere else that the US and its allies choose to target for imperial control. Israel does receive the lion's share of US foreign aid, but so do so-called pro-democracy protesters in Hong Kong and puppets who may still end up dead or terrorists attempting to overthrow the Syrian government at the hands of head-chopping terrorists. It is a good thing that it is more difficult to hide Israel's crimes and the suffering of Palestinians. But emphasizing the demolished homes and the families killed is not enough. There has to be a greater understanding of why such obvious wrongdoing is supported by president after president and their foreign allies. We cannot merely see ourselves as well-intentioned people who want to end criminality. That's all well and good. But whether we realize it or not, we are also fighting for vast systemic change. It's funny to me, perhaps ironic is a better word, that Donald Trump was always described as a fascist, and yet Joe Biden, who defeated him, continues the same policies. The US embassy is still in Jerusalem, for example. The JCPOA nuclear agreement with Iran and other nations languishes as the US tries to stick to the new rules, which also came into being because of Trump, who we are supposed to see as being uniquely evil among US presidents. We also cannot separate the international from the domestic. We can't have the nice things I referred to earlier or real democracy when there's an open revolving door from defense contractors straight to the Pentagon. The Biden administration dispensed with rules which would have prevented the current defense secretary from going straight from the Raytheon defense contractor to the Defense Department. The oligarchy takes less and less effort to hide how it does business. The United States and Canada began their existence with European invasions of indigenous lands, just like Columbus did in what became Haiti. Those crimes against humanity led to where we are today, with the descendants of the invaders supporting one another and their crimes committed around the world. The same Europeans who decimated native populations and enslaved Africans are also at the root of Palestine's struggle. Their actions in the region have led to coups, wars, and invasions. The colonial masters are still attempting to be the modern day masters too. The oppression of indigenous peoples in North America differs only from the subjugation of Palestinians in that it began centuries ago. But it would be a mistake to see Israel as being very different from its settler colonial precursors. Israel and the US are literal partners in crime, with American police training in Israel in order to bring their terrorism here to people in this country. And that is the connection we see around the world. The liberation movements cannot be separated, and we must definitely see ourselves as being in need of freedom too. It can truthfully be said that we are all Palestinians. Thank you. Thank you very much.